recourse to president's rule does not mean a one-man rule. In essence, it only means that during the proclamation, responsible government in the state is replaced by responsible government by the Council of Ministers at the center, which becomes answerable to Parliament in respect of all matters concerning the administration of the state. All of you are aware that there cannot be any other guide or support other than the provisions of the Constitution to assist you in assessing delicate situations. In assessing situations inevitably surrounded by political excitement, urgency and controversy, it may also happen that you may not have all the time which you may ordinarily wish for to arrive at your own conclusions regarding the potentialities of a particular situation. Thus, where a ministerial crisis develops before the budget had been passed by the legislature or before even a vote on account had been taken, your assessment will have to race against time, lest for failure to obtain grants for the legislature of the parliament, the entire administration of the state should come to stand still. Apart from the fact that Constitution does not envisage the formulation of any guidelines, we have to remember that it would not be possible to anticipate the situations likely to arise in the future, which would necessitate the use of the discretionary power by the governor. A careful analysis of the circumstances leading to the issue of proclamation under Article 365 in different states would reveal that circumstances have been most dissimilar and each situation had its own distinct features. Such a study would make it obvious that it would not at all be easy to formulate any general guidelines which would be of any advantage to you. I am sure all of you have studied the report of the Committee of Governors that had gone into these problems with great care. The committee observed, even if it were permissible under the Constitution to lay down some kind of guidelines for governors, such a task would be best with many difficulties. While one may discuss the various aspects of the problems which have arisen in the past, it is not easy to envisage all situations which may confront the governors in the future. In the working of the government of the state, large number of problems arises. Therefore, it would be difficult to enunciate a code which may be made automatically applicable to all future situations. I have reminded you of each aspect because these issues would continue to come up for discussion in Parliament and in other forums, and it would be useful if all of you are fully aware of the position that a governor has to act only according to the Constitution, his oath of office and his own individual judgment while dealing with difficult situations of this nature that may arise from time to time. As chancellors of universities, governors have a tremendous opportunity to remain in touch not only with the elite and the intellectual world, but also with the student community, who are increasingly playing an important part in the body politic. In their own way, the governors have an opportunity to inspire the student community in general with the ideals and values of our constitution. The students too have their own problems, difficulties and frustrations. You can act as a bridge between them and state administration, and your experience of men and affairs should be found useful both by the student and the state administration in finding practical and constructive solutions to the issues which agitate the minds of the students and baffle the ingenuity of to the administration. Apart from this, the governor chancellors can take a keen interest in the welfare programs of the youth and also in sports and other extracurricular activities. I would be exceedingly happy if you were to perform such a useful role that could be of great benefit to the country as a whole. I hope you have gone through the note circulated to you on the 15th report of the Commissioner for Linguistic Minorities in India for the period July 1972 to June 1973. I am sure you are aware in greater detail of the problems and difficulties faced by the linguistic minorities in your state. You will agree that it would not be at all possible to ensure that no state has any linguistic minority within its area. As the country makes further progress in the field of industry and trade, we should expect a larger volume of mobility between the different parts of the country, and this can considerably increase the size of linguistic minorities in different states. It is therefore of utmost importance that persons belonging to the minority groups do not suffer from any sense of justice, whether in the field of education or employment. All the states have accepted the recommendations of the Chief Ministers' Conference.